Crescent City Steakhouse, a true neighborhood restaurant operated by the Vojkovich family since 1934, is the oldest steakhouse in the city of New Orleans. Serving only hand-cut, prime-age, corn-fed beef for over 80 years, Crescent City Steakhouse has become a dining destination for both diehard locals and adventurous travelers who seek traditional, timeless New Orleans cuisine. Crescent City Steakhouse, 1001 North Broad, on the corner of St. Philip, in the heart of New Orleans.
Hey, don't forget my pimento cheese.
Of course.
It's okay, I'll take it from here.
For the love of palmetto cheese. Fall in love with autumn with PJ's new seasonal lattes. Our pumpkin latte brings you all the flavors of a pumpkin pie with hints of cinnamon and nutmeg, like your favorite holiday dessert in a cup. And our s'mores latte with flavors of toasted marshmallows, warm milk chocolate, and graham cracker cinnamon is sure to bring back campfire memories. The PJ's fall seasonal lattes. Available at your local PJs only for a limited time.
Good evening and welcome to Primetime Sports. Hey, I'm your host Scott Alexander, and I cannot wait for this show because when I was a kid, we used to get so excited on those rare weekends when the Saints, the LSU Tigers, and the Tulane Green Wave all won the same weekend, and that's what just happened. Hey, listen, we know LSU and Tulane had inferior opponents, but they still won convincingly, and then the Saints. Let's go there. They went from unwatchable for three quarters to unstoppable in the fourth quarter. They were down 26-10. They were looking horrific. But then they had the biggest fourth quarter comeback in Saints history. You remember when they came back from 15 just a few years ago against the Skins? Well, they came back and Lutz's 51-yard field goal with no time, with just a few seconds left on the clock, won the game. He did the same thing back in 2019, opened the season against the Texans with a 58-yard field goal to win that. But what a great way to start the season. And then you have Tampa Bay coming up this week with Tom Brady. Let's go to LSU. They bounced back from that tough 24-23 loss with a 65-17 victory over the Southern Jaguars, representing the 225, both of them. And their 37 points in the first quarter was the most ever for a Tiger team in any quarter in history. Mississippi State will provide a big challenge this weekend in their SEC opener. How about Tulane, though? They won 52-0 after coming on the heels of the 42-10 win just a week before. That's their first shutout in 25 years. They have a big opponent this coming up week. They got to go to K-State to play Deuce Vaughn in that great defense up there in Manhattan, Kansas. But how about this pro weekend for LSU alumni? Truly remarkable. If you play fantasy, take the quarterback out. For all the other positions on the field, LSU alum had five of the top 20 fantasy weeks of any players in fantasy in the NFL. That's remarkable. Let's start with Justin Jefferson. My goodness, the league I was in, this guy was drafted number one, and not one other person is an LSU guy. He had an amazing game in this one. He had nine receptions, 184 yards, and two touchdowns in the decisive win for the Vikings over Aaron Rodgers. Aaron Rodgers called him the best player in the game today. That is from the greatest quarterback in our generation right now, post Tom Brady, and moving forward. That's remarkable praise right there. Ja'Marr Chase, his teammate, national champion at LSU. He thought he had the game-winning touchdown, and they got the extra point blocked, but his comeback and the way he played, 10 receptions, 127 yards, remarkable game. Joe Burrow, who had five turnovers, still almost came back from another huge deficit. Remember, they had double-digit deficits throughout the playoffs, and he came back and won. He fell just short in this one. How about Jarvis Landry, though? The Saints, seven catches, 114 yards. And then moving forward, let's go to Clyde Edwards-Helaire. He had two touchdowns in the first half of the Chiefs' blowout win, and another LSU running back on Sunday night. Leonard Fournette, we'll see him this Sunday, had 127 yards, tough yards, and that was the most he's had since he's been with the Bucs. How about Cade York, the rookie in his first game ever, a 58-yard game-winning field goal for the Cleveland Browns, beating the Carolina Panthers. And Tulane, we're not going to leave you out. Dontrell Hilliard had two TD receptions for the Titans. Hey, coming up, we have a great show. We're going to talk Saints with Mike Triplett next. We got Tulane talk, but we also have Ryan Schimpf, who is with three guys, Babe Ruth. We got Babe Ruth, we got Barry Bonds, and we also have another great hitter. He's got a stat that will blow you away. He's fourth on the list in all-time baseball history for power. Coming up next right here on Primetime Sports.
Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sports. In this Saints game this past weekend, it was one of the craziest we've seen in years, and we've seen a ton of crazy Atlanta Falcons Saints games, but this one turned out positive, unlike those times in 78 and 79. You remember Big Ben and the referee Grover Clemmer's interference call in Fulton County Stadium. We have a guy with us now that's been covering the Saints for almost 19 years. He's been with ESPN for 9. He was with the Times-Picayune before that. And he's been on this show several times. But it's the first time in a few years. We have Mike Triplett. What has happened to my friend?
Thanks for having me. Yeah, you don't have to go back to the 70s. How about the Saints-Falcons game just last year?
It just seems like every year, doesn't it?
If the karma's going to go this way this year, the Saints were owed a few of these from
last
season.
We have been owed. I got to tell you, what's your first Saints-Falcons memory? That's just your guy from Iowa.
Iowa? So I started covering the team in 05, so my first Saints-Falcons memory is 06. But
that's pretty remarkable.
The Gleason game, but that's not true, actually. I remember the playoff game as, you know, even growing up in
Michael
Iowa.
Michael Haynes, 1991-ish.
Yeah, Deion Sanders in primetime and
the Saints-Falcons.
I cried
like a baby.
I probably had like Bobby Hebert and Aaron Brooks on fantasy teams.
Did you? Know?
So I, yeah. You
Bobby
know?
Would have been that cusp of just starting the fantasy stuff.
Yeah.
Did you do well? Because he had that one good year with the Falcons. But
I'm trying to think of who I did like having Aaron Brooks on my fantasy teams, but maybe
I have a question about that.
I don't know if Bobby Hebert was ever my starter.
That's funny. I don't think he's my starter. That defense maybe. But I have a question because I asked a guy last week who's a young guy, 26 years old. When you hear the Saints, you know, you're not from here, but when you hear, like, the Saints' best quarterbacks in history, in me, it's automatic. Breeze, Archie Manning, Bobby Hebert, period. But if you're under, like, 35, I always hear Aaron Brooks. Aaron Brooks is better than Archie Manning. I hear this, and I'm like, y'all are out of your mind. You're out of your mind just because he put up some stats.
You know what, though? I think the way Brooks' career ended probably took a little. We had this discussion, you know, in the Saints Hall of Fame committee when we put him in. I mean, his numbers and where he took them, I think what happened was the expectations, because of Aaron Brooks' performance himself, got so high that the disappointment was so crushing when he didn't live up to them because but the things that, you know, I think Jim Haslett should be in there one day, too. The things they did in those first few years together are what raised the bar as high as they did.
I don't doubt that he should be in the Hall of Fame. First playoff win, he did put up extraordinary numbers. But Archie was in a different era.
Oh, yeah. I'm not going to rank him.
But also Jeff Blake. That was Jeff Blake's team. Yeah. I remember that. And
I was
kind of took
Jeff
over.
Blake fan, too.
Same here. Love Jeff Blake. Let's get on to first of all, you. You said this summer you have exciting news, and I don't know when you're going to announce this, but you're still with ESPN now, correct?
I'm still with ESPN right now, and I'll still be covering the Saints. But, there'll be an announcement soon.
Okay, can't wait. Okay, you're going to hopefully stay in town maybe?
Yeah, I will still be covering
the
Saints.
That's news. I just broke that news. He's not leaving. All right. Now, we talked about Saints-Falcons. What's your favorite Saints memory out of the last 19 years?
Well, I mentioned the Gleason block punt, and got to cover the Super Bowl. So, I mean, those are the ones. But I would say maybe the underrated memory of getting to cover those years was the 2011 season. It's a huge crushing disappointment, but
the greatest
there's a
team.
Chance that was the best offense in NFL history that season. They still have the record for the most yards. I mean, we could list the name.
It was so easy to score. And then when Pierre Thomas got to the goal line and got the concussion, and it just seemed like the one play
that changed everything. They win the Super Bowl if that one play doesn't happen. I honestly think if you change one play in Saints history, they go to the Super Bowl if you change the no call in the 2018
game. The no call,
game.
Too. But like one last thing on that. I was with a Giants fan. I work with Fox every weekend, and one guy comes from New York, and he, every time the Saints come up, he's like, thank goodness. All the Giants fans knew that they were going to get their butt kicked in the dome against that team if the Saints had won.
That, getting to cover that, like, that is my first memory. Like, so, my 18th season covering the Saints, and my first memory of the team I've covered over that span is that peak. I mean, Drew Brees throwing for 5,500 yards to Colston and Jimmy Graham and Lance Moore and Robert Meacham and Devery Henderson and Pierre Thomas and Darren Sproles and Mark.
They roll off your tongue. I love it.
But,
crazy.
Especially last year when they couldn't find any reliable targets.
I know.
They used to have, like, 14.
That's so nuts. I still to this day, I've always said that's the best Saints team ever.
Yeah, and look, and Jari Evans and Carl Nix were both first team all pro guards on that team.
Arguably one of the best guard pairs in NFL.
There's really a case to be made for that being, you know, at their peak, the best offense in NFL history. It's on a short list.
I'm with you. This year's Saints, not the best offense in NFL history, but that fourth quarter. That was one of the best fourth quarters we've seen in the Saints' history.
Yeah, look, really promising. So I think locally more than nationally, we've all been a little bit more bullish on the Saints this year. I think nationally you're like, oh, Dennis Allen and Jameis Winston, I don't know. But we look at, well, look what they did last year.
Right.
And when everything was going wrong and they had no offensive line and they had no playmakers and, you know, all the starters falling by the wayside. And how can it not be better this year on offense? We know that the defense is really good. And so we saw a glimpse of it. I mean, obviously things did not start out well, and this is not going to be a perfect team this year. But to know that when they got to have it, they have a little firepower.
Right.
They shouldn't get down by 16 every week. But that is an element they did not have. If they ever got down by 16 last year, it was over.
No chance. We saw it around the Thanksgiving period, the Cowboys game, the Bills game, the Dolphins game. It was impossible to come back. What can this team do? Because you said something. I remember when the Saints went 8-8 in 2008, and we knew how many close losses there were.
Yeah.
We knew that this could be something special. And I think, I'm not saying this is Super Bowl caliber, but we know how good the defense is. What would you say to someone from somewhere else that says the Saints have no chance to go to the Super Bowl?
Well, they're in the NFC, so they have a chance.
Good point.
especially when Green Bay lost, the Rams lost, the 49ers lost. I mean, the entire NFC East is in shambles. So the NFC.
So you're saying there's a chance?
They've got a really good chance, but what actually worries me is. Even before the Falcons game, I thought there's no way the defense can be as good as they might have been. Second half of last season, they might have been the best defense in the NFL.
Right.
And so I figured they'll probably take a small step back, the defense, but it's still an excellent defense. The offense has to take 10 steps forward from what it was last year. And this was virtually a playoff team last year. So I've been picking them to go 10-7. I think 11-6 is possible. I think 12-5 is possible if they get the injury luck and everything like that. But, I mean, if the offense really starts clicking, Jameis is such an unknown.
Right.
He still, even though he's been in the league for so long, he still has the potential to have by far his best season with these guys around him. He's already got the connection with Michael Thomas, Jarvis Landry, and Chris Olave all in the first game. You've seen what they can do. So I'm not going to put a limit on what they can do, but obviously you need to temper your expectations a little bit. They're not a perfect team, and they are an injury away on the offensive line, the defensive line, the secondary from having some troubles. But if they have a little better luck with injuries than they had last year, it's a huge disappointment that there's not a playoff team at the very least.
Since you mentioned that about positions, what position, including the depth at that position, would you say is the strongest on this team?
The strongest on this team? It's crazy to think it's wide receiver when it was the worst one last year, but I think it's wide receiver. Here's the one I want to find out more about is that defensive line.
Because
I think that era from 2017 through 2020 where they won the NFC South 4 years in a row.
Yeah.
I think the defensive line and the front seven in general was the strength of this team.
No question.
Adding DeMario Davis in
right.
there. I'm a little curious now. I think it has to be. We saw them not show up for this first game in a big way, but I think a lot of that was because they were sort of playing that sit back and corral Marcus Mariota instead of attack and pressure. And obviously I think we'll see a different game plan going forward against other styles of offenses, starting with Tom Brady and the Buccaneers. But Cam Jordan has continued to bring it for, you know, 11, 12 years. Can he continue at that pace? Marcus Davenport, when healthy, at sometimes has been the best player on the entire
defense. I agree, man. I've been saying this.
Can he finally have his breakthrough season? Can Peyton Turner finally show up? Can David Onyemata get back to where he was 2 years ago? They need to. They need to for this team to be special.
The defensive end position was kind of what I was hitting at. We know wide receiver because you got that Peyton Turner, you can start rotating. I mean, I don't know. Cam Jordan's used to playing almost every down all the time. They said something about maybe rotating, keeping these guys fresh. Yeah. You see them, they're going
to
do that.
That's always been their plan. Cam Jordan used to be the exception to that, but Ryan Nielsen pointed out last week that he already cut down his snaps last year, and that's the goal this year. They have a lot of depth. Actually, they're so deep at defensive end. They had Tano Passignon as a healthy and active.
100.
That is a position where they have a lot of guys to choose from, but they need to be special. I mean, I really do think one of the make-or-break players on this team is Marcus Davenport. You know, if he just plays like 14 games finally, I think he'd have a 14-sack season. You know, Trey Hendrickson is doing the things that Marcus Davenport is capable of. That should be his path.
Well, I've said this for the last 2-3 years. I said when he's healthy, he's healthy, he's one of the most destructive human beings in the NFL.
There were times before Cam Jordan finished so strong down the stretch at the end of last season, I'd say right around midseason, Marcus Davenport was probably the strength of their defense at one point last year.
What did you see from the offensive line this week?
It wasn't great, but they got beat more by blitzes that they didn't pick up, I think. Which is still their fault, but it's not like they were getting overpowered, except for Grady Jackson against the guards a couple of times. So I think correctable things, game planning things, week one rust things.
Right.
I mean, we have to throw week one in the we have a survivor pool, you know, where
a lot of people lost
65%.
Jerry Smith said he got two chances. He got another chance last night with Denver. He said he's out.
I mean, it's unbelievable. So week one, and I mean, look what happened last year. The Saints beat the Packers 38-3. Week one is a little bit of an anomaly. I think the offensive line will be a strength of this team, but the guards came into the year as a question mark. Like, will Cesar Ruiz and Andres Pete finally have a good, reliable year? And to see them struggle in that game was disheartening, but I think it's too small of a sample size to say they're going to be a liability. I mean, there were so many positive reasons to think Ruiz could finally break through this year that hopefully Grady Jackson just gave him a little bit of a welcome to year three, and he cleans it up from there.
Good luck, boy. Hey, I got a question. What was your first reaction 2 weeks ago when you heard about the Chauncey Gardner-Johnson trade? You're more on the inside than a lot of reporters, so you know what's going on.
Well,
what was your first reaction?
Couple reactions. My first reaction to him being traded was not shock. I would have predicted that he was never going to get that next contract, that they didn't want to make that commitment to him. I think that had started to become pretty evident. And then immediately you're like, oh, they've been planning for this because Alante Taylor in round 2 of the draft, who's that versatile type of DB, and then Tyrann Mathieu to a multi-year deal in free agency.
Right.
They look like a team that was preparing to not have Gardner-Johnson long-term. I thought he'd play out this season.
Yeah, couldn't we wait after the Tom Brady game so we'd see a little accident like this?
And I also, obviously, everybody thought they would get more for him than they did. But when I saw, my first reaction when I saw what they got for him was basically, oh, so they just cut him.
That's like a slap in the face. I mean,
just
that's just like, boom.
Like,
there you go here. I missed that.
Yeah,
that's what I wanted to see one more time.
Exactly. And they're going to miss him in this matchup in particular, although Chris Godwin might not play. He's made his reputation on covering Chris Godwin and getting to that guy. But I think the one false reaction, I think, is when everybody was like, what a stupid trade. Why do the Saints want a fifth and sixth round pick? They should have just cut him so that nobody thinks they made a bad trade. They decided that they didn't want him. Now, I haven't heard every detail about why that was, but all the evidence you need is right there. They basically decided they don't want him on this team. They wouldn't have traded him.
100%. That's what I wanted to ask you. That's what I wanted to ask you, because sometimes his passion was infectious, but sometimes that passion, as you know, in some relationships can go the other way and be detrimental.
And I really do think the contract talks made that get really divisive, without a question. Like, you know, that can go either way. So in some ways it led to a divide between Jimmy Graham that, you know, it wasn't from point A to point B when they traded
Bobby
Jimmy Graham.
Bobby Aber, it goes way back. Yeah. I mean, he sat out a full year.
But when they traded Jimmy Graham, they got a lot for him. That
was
the main reason they did that deal. In this case, I really think that relationship got really sour when he wasn't getting the contract he wanted. And, you know, you can
ultimately blame them. I mean, it reminds me a little of when they basically gave away Akeem Hicks for nothing.
Yes.
They just decided,
yes,
this player is not working out the way we want to. They trade him for Michael Omanui with the Patriots.
Right.
That's all you got for Akeem Hicks? Yeah. Akeem Hicks has had this incredible
career. You got a lot of letters in that name, though.
Yeah.
A lot of vowels.
So that's what it reminds me of, in that I'm sure Gardner Johnson is going to continue to have a great career, and no one's ever going to be like, the Saints were proven right, but that's what they decided. They clearly decided this would be an addition.
It was obvious.
Attraction for them. Yeah.
I got to ask you, because the Buccaneers are coming up, and obviously everybody remembers the playoff game with the fumble, obviously from tight end, it was a Cook.
Yep.
Well, but the four regular season games,
yeah,
the Saints have dominated this team,
yep,
twice, not even allowing a touchdown, one shot at one. Why do they play so well against,
right,
Tom Brady? And
well, I mean, that's probably a story I'm going to try to get to the heart of this week. The simplest way is, I think they realize that, people say all the time, if you can pressure him up the middle, going back to Carl Nixon, Jerry Evans, and the importance,
yeah,
of guard play, if you can pressure him up the middle, you can throw him off a little bit. Saints have been excellent at that with their big defensive line. They don't always need to blitz to do that either. They can get there with the defensive line. And then the matchups in the secondary, C.J. Gardner-Johnson against Chris Godwin, Marshawn Lattimore against Mike Evans, obviously. And so Dennis Allen, who doesn't like to give anything away, said those are the two things. You got to disrupt his timing some way, somehow. You either got to pressure him, or you got to knock the receivers off the routes, so you got to do both. And the Saints have had the personnel to do both of those things. Easier said than done sometimes, but they've been excellent at those two things.
And while I have you, because obviously they play well against him, why do they have such a hard time with guys trying to contain the run-pass guys?
We'll find out when they have to go back to Philadelphia again later this year, right?
I mean, getting murdered, right?
I mean, look, one of the things we used to see this with Cam Newton, too, is you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. If you decide to sit back and not be aggressive against those guys, I guarantee you they wish they had tried a different. I think they probably thought, let's make Mariota stand in the pocket and beat us, instead of letting him scramble against us. But they got tore up by the run game in that. I guarantee you it'll look different the next time they play Atlanta this year.
I'm very curious about this weekend. How do you see this game? I'm not asking for prediction, but how do you see it going?
I mean,
low scoring, high scoring.
It's hard not to think that they're going to continue to have success because they've got something figured out, and they've still got Dennis Allen and Ryan Nielsen and Chris Richard and Michael Hodges pulling the strings there. But I also am sure that the greatest quarterback in NFL history
gotta
has
figure
been
it out
thinking
sooner
about
later, right?
How can I do something.
He doesn't want this on his record to be 0-5 against the Saints.
Yeah, no, it's a huge question mark, though, because the Saints' secondary is so different. It would really help if Paulson Adebo can come back from injury.
Is that happening?
I don't know. I did not think he was supposed to miss a lot of time, so I think there's positive hope for that. But two new safeties, a new nickel from the last time they played him. So they're going to have to prove they can continue to do it all over again without the same personnel that they've had.
You've signed this ball before,
yeah,
so we're going to leave it
all
alone right now. So I got to get new balls. Got to remember out of space. But we do give gifts. I think you remember, this is not your first rodeo.
The only reason I came.
I know. I figured, man, you need some pants, right? I'll get you those. So, no, Task Performance.
Thank you.
And this
I
is probably your
that.
Third or fourth one from here. And also, please take your beautiful wife to Shays de la Shays.
I will.
I know you've been there before, too, huh?
And it's excellent. Thank
Mike,
you very much.
Good luck. I appreciate you, and I can't wait to hear the news, and we might hear it soon.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mike Triplett's going places, y'all, but he's staying in New Orleans. That's the best news I've heard in a long time, because I didn't know. I heard this summer he's got some crazy things. I thought ESPN might bring him to Bristol, but we're glad you're here. Hey, we're going to switch gears a little bit. We're going to go to football later again. I've got Gary Smith. I haven't talked about the Wave in a while, but next I've got one of the craziest stories in Major League and LSU history. One of the best players literally in LSU baseball history. His name's Ryan Schiff, and he was on national champion team. You should see the stats he had that year. One of the best players in college baseball. Coming up next, right here on Primetime Sports.
Goldmine, 701 Dauphine Street, New Orleans.
You got to spread joy up to the maximum and bring gloom down.
Rock and roll will never die. It's old New Orleans, my oh my. Come on, baby, let's go rock and roll.
the city lane. All night, let's roll, let's rock and roll. Baby, do the rock and roll. At Mid-City Lane, the home of rock and roll.
The owners of the Delachaise Wine Bar on St. Charles Avenue have opened up their newest creation uptown on Maple Street called Chez Delachaise, a new local wine bistro featuring a larger menu of small and large plates, a brighter atmosphere, and full table service. Additionally, patrons can enjoy a large patio out front as well as an extensive wine list offering selections from around the world. It's Chez Delachaise, 7708 Maple Street between Carrollton and Broadway.
Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sports. We're gonna take a quick break from football because this is baseball season still in the major leagues. The pennant races are winding down. We're gonna have the playoffs coming up in just a few weeks. We're gonna talk about LSU baseball. We had Jay Johnson, the head coach, on recently. We've had Skip Bertman and Paul Maneri on, obviously, former LSU managers, head coaches there as well. But from that 2009 national championship team, Blake Deem was on this show just a couple weeks ago. He's been on many times. We've also had Chad Jones in the first year of doing this show. And obviously Maneri, and then Bertman was the AD back then. But now I have another member of that great team, one of the best hitters in college baseball that year and one of the best players in LSU baseball history. He went on to play in the major leagues, San Diego Padres and a few other teams as well. Here he is, Ryan Schimpf. How are you, my friend?
Good. I appreciate you having me.
Good to see you. Local boy.
Yeah.
From New Orleans, went to St. Paul's and then on to LSU. Talk about that growing up in New Orleans.
Yeah, I mean, that was a dream. They could have offered me, they did offer me books, but they really didn't have to offer me anything. I was going, so.
You loved LSU that much?
Yeah, I mean, I always thought I was going to be LSU football player, but then I stopped growing, so boys got a little bigger. But, yeah, it was purple and gold for me, you know, childhood dream, and I couldn't be happier and luckier, you know, not only to go there, but to win a national championship there.
What's your first baseball memory of LSU Tigers as a kid?
You know, obviously 96, Warren Morris hitting the big homer.
The greatest moment in LSU sports history. I tell people all the time. The national championships in football are great, but that one moment, win or lose at that at-bat, and they end up winning the game.
There's no doubt. I mean, between that and then 97, just them just hitting homer after homer, gorilla ball.
Yeah.
Man, a lot of ones. So, you know, I couldn't be luckier to have been a Tiger and just be part of that group before me, because those, for me, those were the big leaguers. You know, I didn't have a major league team. That was my major league team.
Those are the guys you grew up with watching. So you graduated high school in 06. Mm-hmm. You played LSU 07, 08, 09. You went to the World Series, I believe, in 08. I remember mm-hmm. that team
yeah.
well. How did that loss in that World Series, because that was a dynamic team, propel you the following year to get that national championship?
There's no question that 08 set the foundation for us, because we started off 2007, weren't very good. 2008 to start, we kind of scuffling halfway through, but that definitely propelled us because we went 23 games straight.
Yeah.
And that definitely got our confidence to where we didn't know how good we could have been to start that year, but you win 23 in a row, you're like, and you go to Omaha, you're like, I think we got something here.
It was unbelievable run.
And then we got that little taste of getting to Omaha, and then 09, there was no question that we were going to win it. So just being there, we had to seal a deal in 09.
So you have that confidence. I love that, because you said there's no question. Baseball is the hardest sport to me to win. I mean, basketball, you got that one game. But when you go to the World Series, there's eight teams that think they all going to win. What gave you so much confidence that that was y'all's year?
Losing in 08,
mm-hmm.
That for sure. You know, really just, it's a special team. Not only were we good, but I mean, I think the best teams are good off the field too. So we just spent so much time, because we were, you know, very mediocre
yeah.
at best, 07 and to start 08, that we put in so much time training, working out together that, you know, we built the trust, the confidence. We knew everything about each other. And then once we got that taste in 08, the combination of all of that definitely just made us sure that we were going to win it in 09. There was no other option. I know it's hard to say.
I love stories like this for this show, because not only, because this show is all about people that are either from here that have done great things, or people like the Breeze types that come and do great things in the state of Louisiana. Carl Malone's from Louisiana, yeah, but didn't really do a whole lot here except Louisiana Tech. But you are from here. You played high school ball here. You played for LSU, and then you went on to be in the major leagues. When you got drafted in the fifth round after your third year with the Toronto Blue Jays, and think back to when you were a kid before that, like, is this a dream just realized? I mean, what was that moment feel like for you?
Definitely surreal. I might be a little bit different than everybody else, but I grew up, for me, the big leagues was LSU.
Yeah.
So, I honestly didn't.
I love that you just said that.
I did not get too far ahead. I always knew I was going to be, I always had the ability to do it, but I never looked beyond that. So once I got, once we got to the point where hey, this is going to be a reality here that I'm going to get a chance to play pro ball, then it was, what's next? But for me, we were so focused on, for me and the guys around me, we were so focused on LSU winning the championship to where I didn't think too far ahead, because the draft was in the middle of the Super Regional. So
sure, that's right.
I think if we got our heads fogged up with it,
that's a good point.
Was hard to not be distracted by it. But we did a very good job of focusing on LSU because, for me that was easy. It was from here, that's all I cared about. Win a national championship, which is what makes LSU so special, especially being from here.
I'm going to say this. I asked Blake this 2 weeks ago, and I've had him on many times, but I had never asked this question. And it was an easy answer for him. I said, what is the one moment you remember? He goes, the walk-off home run postseason 09. I'll never forget that. But for you, if there's one moment you can think about, it could be a personal moment or it could be a team moment. What was that one moment that you think first when you think of LSU baseball and Ryan Schiff?
Selfishly, you want to think of something you did good. I mean,
we'll do that first. Let's do that. Don't be bashful.
We had a big home run against Rice.
Yes, in the World Series.
In the Super Regionals.
Super Regionals, right.
In 09.
Right.
It was a big deal because it was a lefty. I think we were down 5-3 maybe, and it was a 3-run homer. Coach Maneri was talking to me about, they bring in a lefty to face me, and he's talking about watch the slider, watch this and that. I'm like, all right, let me get in my zone here.
Right.
And then sure enough, you just kind of black out, boom, he hangs the slider, 3-run homer. So selfishly, that one.
Uh-huh.
But that's
what I'm talking about. They don't probably even get to the World Series with that one. I mean, if you're down 5-3 at that point, I know it's a 2-out-of-3 thing.
It was it was huge. I mean, and just the coolest thing about it is being able to go back and watch it and seeing the fans' reaction, because that's what makes it all worth it. Seeing everybody go wild. I mean, that's the thing you're going to remember forever. But I mean, we spent so much time as far as what do you remember most? I mean, it's really cliche, but it's about the time you spent with the guys, not just one thing, not just the dog pile, but everything that accumulated and built up to that point is just the stuff that I'm going to remember forever. And I think most of the guys would say the same.
It's funny you said the dog pile. That's one shot, but the shot that I will always remember, this one.
Yeah.
Diving in. Is that Jones? Who is that right there diving in?
Leon Landry at the top.
Leon Landry.
I think if you could go back in time, you want to strategically place yourself.
Right.
What can I be remembered forever here?
I mean, look at this. There's nothing but joy right here.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm a claustrophobic guy. I've always been like, please don't put me on the bottom of any pile.
Yeah.
If I had the game-winning, catching out there, I'd be like, throw the ball away and just run away. But let me talk about this. You mentioned something that the time spent with the players, and you said something about your 7 years in the minors. We talked off camera. And you said, what I remember most, I love the stuff, not these moments on the field, but the stuff we did, the bus rides. Because people don't know, really, that baseball players go through, they don't always have the charter jets, right? They're taking bus rides from town to town when you're in the minor leagues. Explain that experience and persevering through that whole time.
Yeah, I mean, pro ball minor leagues is not glamorous by any means, especially going from LSU, which was the top.
Right.
You have a $50 million stadium, chartered flights, and then you go to the Baymont Inn in Dunedin, Florida. You're like, did I make the right decision here?
That is exactly what Blake said. He goes, man, we had LSU, and then we're traveling some places in Idaho.
Yeah, it's definitely a culture shock for sure. But, I mean, I love the game. I love putting in the work. I would have never made it as far as I did if I didn't. I had to work a little extra than some. So I love that part. But yeah, not glamorous. The bus rides, you got 6 to 12 hour bus trips sometimes in the minor leagues, eating peanut butter and jelly, then putting some marshmallow spread just to fill it up, fill your belly up. So and not making any money on top of it, but I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world.
So I covered the Braves for 14 years. So I remember guys that would get called up, and even Chipper. Man, Chipper was minors for a year, and then he got called up in '95, the year they won the title. But the first time they see the spreads, the food, you know, back in the day they had any beer you wanted in there. I mean, it was like, and it's just like from going from the minor leagues where you just maybe getting a little McDonald's after the game, you're going to go to sleep, you got another game. What's that feeling like that you've made it? I mean, you know when you get called up, you're not there for good, but you're there for that moment.
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, one of my coaches always said, think of the big leagues and multiply it times 10, and he's right. It's hard to describe until you get there. Yeah, that's the one thing everybody talks about is the food, because the minor leagues, the food was so terrible. It's gotten better, but yeah, you definitely eat good, and it's easy to put on some pounds when you're there, for sure. But I mean, it's everything you ever wanted as far as the food, the travel, anything you want, you know, you can get it.
I gotta say this, because I teased this in the open, and this is an incredible stat. ISO is isolated power, and you're fourth of all time. I'm talking about in the history of baseball, which has been happening for about 160 years. There's three names ahead of you. Isolated power is basically your slugging percentage, I think, minus the batting average. It's basically how many total bases you have per at-bat. And yours is extraordinary. And you were all on ESPN like for about 3 weeks straight. I just remember thinking, oh, my God, look at them. But Babe Ruth is number one of all time. Number two is Mark McGwire. And number three, I said this earlier, is who's my boy? Oh, Barry Bonds, and you're number four. You're ahead of like guys like David Ortiz and Mickey Mantle, and the list goes on. That is remarkable. That's not like if you have to have at least 500 at bats. That's the criteria. But when you hear yourself with those names, and these guys are all monstrous. I never saw Babe Ruth live, but I've seen pictures. We know how big Barry got, and Barry was always a great player. But and Mark McGwire is a giant. What goes to your head? Because that's remarkable. I think that's going to shock everybody that's watching the show.
Yeah, you don't have to be big, number one. But yeah, I mean, it's cool. I mean, I've never really thought about it or heard of it until probably I was done. But yeah, if I'm in company with those guys, I will take it.
I think so.
You know, maybe you want to mix in a few more singles, but I think I was always a power guy. So that was my objective, was get extra bases for sure. And I mean, interestingly enough, it was pretty cool that McGwire was a coach of mine when I was there with San Diego doing it.
When you came up?
Yeah. Yeah, he was a bench coach. So a lot of his childhood dream, had the big 6'5" monster on the wall when I was a kid. And here he is, my bench coach. Yeah.
That'd be like Pistol Pete being alive and coaching me when I was a kid. No, I have to ask you about going up, because you had that monster start. And describe what it was for those that don't know. Because you came up, you've been tolling in the minors, but you had a great minor league season that year with El Paso, the Chihuahuas. You get the call up, your parents are actually with you, and you said, hey, let's go to San Diego. First at bat, you get on base, hit. Talk about that, and talk about that run, because and tell people, because I don't remember the exact numbers, but tell people what you did off the bat, because it was, like I said, it was on SportsCenter, seemed like every night.
Yeah, it was definitely kind of a fairy tale first year, for sure. I mean, had a great start with the Chihuahuas in El Paso. This is the first time where my wife and my daughter, you know, we were there as a family, because you're
2016, right?
Yeah, 2016. Yeah. Before, you're not making any money, so my wife had to work at the time, and we couldn't just pick up and leave and, you know, live off of nothing. So we were able to be together as a family. So it was a great year to spend it with my wife and my daughter for full time.
Right.
And then had a great run there, and then my mom and dad were there when I got called up.
Right?
So, I mean, I couldn't have drawn it up any better. And then I finally get there. Didn't think I was playing at the time. You know, got the call. You never know how you're going to react when you get the call, but definitely surreal, kind of hyperventilating. You've been waiting 8 years for this moment. And then so we finally pack up. We go. Luckily, it's pretty close. So mom and dad, wife, and my daughter were able to come, and I walk in the locker room, got 1 hour of sleep. I'm like, surely they're going to give me an off day here.
No.
And I walk in, I see
your name on the starting lineup.
Six playing third. I'm like, whew.
Now, did you play third? I mean, I knew you were second baseman, but what position did you play coming up?
I'm mostly second, but bounced around. Right. In 2016, I was playing mostly third, which is why they put me at third to start.
Uh-huh.
And then we needed a second baseman, so after that first game, boom, I went to second for the rest of the year. So,
When did you come up? What month was that, and how long did you?
June. So June on, stayed for the rest of the year. And then definitely, it was so surreal. Get a double my first at bat, and you just go numb. And then, as soon as you get a double, you're like,
oh my God, I can do this.
I'm going to be here forever.
Right.
We're going to be 10 years, pencil it in.
Right.
So, I was very fortunate and lucky to have the career and, have the time that I did there and get to experience it with my family, have my wife and my kids there. So, it was great while it lasted, for sure.
Will Clark has been on this show twice, and he sat in that seat, and he talked about his first at-bat was a home run against Nolan Ryan in the Astrodome. And obviously, we know his career. He could have been Hall of Fame without the injuries. But when you talk about how many home runs did you hit? What was the stretch that got you? Was it like consecutive games, home runs? What was it exactly?
So I think I hit 9 in July. So
right.
I had 20 my first season.
I think that's it, Rookie of the Month, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
July Rookie of the Month. Yeah, so hit 9 that month, and I hit 20 my first year, June through the end of September. And then the next year I hit 14 through May or June.
That's remarkable.
So, yeah, man, I was always a homer guy.
Right.
So,
But where do you get that power from? You're not the biggest guy.
When I was a kid, I've always tried to put a finger on it. I mean, number one, I was always pretty, body type wise. I was always in good control of my body, short, stocky, but thick.
Mm-hmm.
But as a kid, I always tried to hit homers. Ever since I was 8 years old, I was a home run hitter. That was always what I wanted to do. Then growing up in the yard, hit rocks into the woods. I never wanted a single. So I think part of that was my objective, number one.
Right.
And then number two, I was very hard worker in the weight room. So always wanted to be stronger than everybody else, even though I wasn't. But
right.
Combination of that, I think. But that was always the objective, is drop the ball.
When were you with the Angels?
That's who I finished with,
okay.
2018. So I started off with Tampa.
Okay.
Got traded during spring training,
okay,
to Atlanta.
So wait a minute, let's go to the history. Toronto for about 7 years in the minors, mm-hmm. right? You get traded to San Diego?
I signed as a minor league free agent in the fall of 2015.
Okay.
So 16 and 17
I got
with
you.
San Diego.
All right.
And then during the winter of 2017, I got traded to Tampa, and then that was a pinball machine there.
Yeah, what happened there?
Started with Tampa in spring training, got traded to Atlanta.
Okay.
And then last day of spring training, we're driving up to Atlanta, me and my wife and kids. I get a call as an hour away from Atlanta saying, hey, you were traded to LA. We don't know if you're going to LA or AAA. I'm like,
what?
Seriously? So we get there, kids jump out in the apartment, run around, get some energy out. We drive back home to Louisiana, and then that's when I went to start off in AAA with LA, and then
was Chief Patella there then?
No, he was done. He wasn't with them at the time.
Right, right. Okay.
I don't know if he was.
He might have moved
not.
On. Right.
But yeah, then got back up with those guys, and then finally stopped playing at the end of that season, 2018.
I tell you what, though, I want to hear what you're doing now, because not many people make the transition as smoothly as you, and now you're making money a different way. Talk about that.
Yeah, so I'm in the mortgage business now as a loan officer with Angel Oak Home Loans. So
jumbo home loans too.
Yeah, we can do that too.
We can do that too.
Yeah, so it was definitely a change for sure. Once you're playing your whole life, but I really want to be around the wife, my wife, and the kids, and it gives me the ability to, be my own boss. And
Nice. That's nice.
And it kind of has the feel like when you're playing baseball, the sky's the limit. You can play as long as you want, make as much as you want. So definitely had a good
eat what you kill.
So that's what I like. I need to keep driving. So I definitely enjoy what I'm doing now for sure.
How many kids do you have now?
Three kids. Under six.
Three under six.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah.
When you went, that was a baby when you went to San Diego.
Yeah, man, it was something I always wanted to do. That's kind of what fueled me. Also, I wanted the opportunity to have my kids grow up in a locker room.
That's beautiful.
And at least be part of it for a little while.
That's beautiful. Hey, we give gifts on this show, and you're going to sign this ball in purple because the post-COVID guests, because the show was off for 2 years, we're signing in purple. And I had the
awesome.
Purple pen, but if I don't have it now, we're going to do
we're
it
gonna
after.
We're going to get it.
But here, Task Performance, this might be your first one ever.
I think so.
You're going to love it?
I love it, man.
I won't be your last, I know. And then if you ever get back, I know you live on the North Shore, but
yeah.
This is a
Any
great restaurant. Right there, uptown by Tulane University. It's between Carrollton and Broadway.
Yeah.
It's on Maple. It's called Chez de la Chez.
Definitely.
This has been a treat, man. This
I
really has
it.
Been.
This is awesome.
Ryan,
thanks,
I appreciate
Fred.
You. This is one of the best players in LSU baseball history. Look up those stats that last year's junior year before he went to the Toronto Blue Jays. Unbelievable. Batted 335-ish, home runs, 21 homers, whatever it was a lot. But right here, LSU baseball is back, but they were back then. That was one of the best teams in LSU baseball history. And I'm including all those teams from the 2000s that I love. They're right there with them. Hey, we're going to change gears right back. We're going to go to football because I haven't talked about the Tulane Green Wave in a few weeks. We're going to have Gary Smith come on. He's going to tell us all about that 2-0 start. They've won 52-0 last week, 42-10 the week before. Now it gets a little tougher. They got to go to Kansas State this weekend. I don't think they're going to score 50, but maybe they can stay in there. Coming up next, right here on Primetime Sports. Welcome back to Primetime Sports. Hey, we had a little baseball fix with Ryan Schimpf. How about that stat? Fourth of all time behind Mark McGwire, Babe Ruth, and whoever that other great hitter was. But right now we're going to switch gears back to football because we talked about the Saints earlier. Next week I have Glenn Gilbo coming to talk about the LSU Tigers. But how about our local college team right here, the Tulane Green Wave? They started the season 2-0. They have the number one pass defense in the country. Now, they hadn't played great opponents yet, but they have outscored their opponents 92-10. That's remarkable. Maybe it's even 94-10. Is it 42-10? 94-10. Gary Smith, welcome to the show.
Yeah, great to be here.
Good to see you. You're the guy that covers the Green Wave in all sports. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe sometimes reporters will come touch on them, but mm-hmm. you're the one dude that yeah. covers everything with the Wave.
Yeah, I'm there every day. Basketball, baseball, football. I'm at every practice, every interview. If you want to read about Tulane,
yeah. How do you read your stuff real quick? Do you still do Wave Report?
Yeah, I do the Wave Report.
Wave Report.
Tulane.rivals.com, the Wave Report.com, and then obviously the Advocate, NOLA.com. Stories every day. It amused me when people tell me, "Hey, Tulane doesn't get any media coverage anymore." Well, they're not reading me because literally I'm covering them every day. There's not a day that I'm not writing something about Tulane football during football season.
Rivals,
yeah,
which I worked for
mm-hmm.
20 years ago, 22 when it first started in the late 90s.
Yeah,
and you got Wave Report.
Yeah.
And you got the Advocate,
mm-hmm.
Times Picayune. I mean, you got all these revenue streams.
Yeah, that's
you're a rich man. Roll Wave, baby.
I wish, but I'll be looking forward to that coupon for the restaurant.
That's it. That's right. Well, that'll get you a few drinks.
It might not
get more than that, but you got that test shirt coming.
That's right.
Hey, let's talk about the Wave mm-hmm. right now, because obviously Willie Fritz has had a successful run at mm-hmm. Tulane, bringing them some bowl games. Last year, we know with the Hurricane Ida displacing the team for a full month to the Birmingham area, and then they had that first game. They almost beat Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. It was so close.
Yeah.
And then the bottom dropped out, and they finished 2-10. Coming into the season, what were your thoughts before the season started?
Yeah, well, my thoughts were really that you could pretty much throw out last year. Too much distractions. It's not easy. They thought they were leaving for 2 days
right.
when they left Ida. They didn't even bring their gear, stuff like that. Families from Louisiana players had their houses destroyed during the hurricane. They played an incredibly tough schedule. There was just too many things that went wrong. But Willie Fritz couldn't look at it that way, so he replaced six of the coaches on his staff and brought in a new strength and conditioning coordinator. So he wasn't just using it as an excuse. He realized something had to change.
Right.
And so really what I see is a team, I'm still going back to the three previous years when they went 7-6, 6-6. He's trying to improve off of that because one of the things he said, they made a bowl game his third year, and he said he went to the coaches' convention afterwards, and they were all coming up to him and congratulating him like he'd won the national championship.
Right.
And he said, that's not what I came here to do, to go 6-6. He has not advanced past that yet. He really thinks that he can do that at Tulane, that 6-6 is not the top that you can get to. He really wants to compete for the American Athletic Conference Championship, be in position to win that, hasn't done that yet. And so I think with the changes he's made on his staff, he feels like they have a chance to get into position this year to finally do that.
Well, you know, everybody wants to talk about the opponent, right? UMass, they beat them by 32. They were favored by 29. Mm-hmm. And then they took out Alcorn State. But that's the first shutout that they've had since 1997. That's
first
25 years.
First year of Tommy Bowden. That's
not even the undefeated year. In 98 they didn't get it. So this is something to talk about. Mm-hmm.
It is. And they went after it. Like they had a chance, like for example, last year they played Morgan State up in Birmingham as one of their home games that was displaced. And Morgan State was a truly awful football team, and Tulane gave up 21 points in that game. This game, the first possession, Tulane committed a turnover. Alcorn State takes over at Tulane's 20-yard line, goes backward a yard, Tulane blocks the field goal, and then never, I don't think Alcorn State crossed the midfield for the rest of the game. Obviously, the opponent wasn't good, but you can't. That Tulane did what you have to do. They dominated a bad opponent, played hard every snap. Tulane has a ton of experience back. This is the most veteran team that will.
Yeah, let's get into that because let's start with the quarterback position. I had Michael Pratt on about 2 or 3 months ago. He came with Willie. I did separate interviews. Mm-hmm. I couldn't have been more impressed with him as a human being.
He's unbelievable. He does everything the right way. And let's face it. Tulane had a horrible year last year. He had a rough time. He didn't really get along with the offensive coordinator, who's now at Georgia Tech.
Right.
He could have left, and he had no, because he's a good quarterback.
He's got NFL possibilities.
There are teams that would have definitely wanted him.
No question.
He had no interest. He wanted to be at Tulane. He's done all the right things. He works incredibly hard, and we're starting to see the results on the field. Again, we'll find out a lot more against Kansas State this Saturday, but his accuracy has improved tremendously. But you could tell he was a winner the very first time he came on the field against Southern Miss 2 years ago. Tulane was really struggling. Keon Howard had beaten him out. Quite frankly, Michael Pratt had not looked that good in preseason. He was a true freshman.
Right, sure.
He comes in, and the second he came in, boom, touchdown. You could just
leadership.
He galvanized the whole team the second he came. It was like a relief for everybody. Wow, this is a guy that can produce. And he was up and down his freshman year, like all freshman quarterbacks can be. But he has a chance to go down as the best Tulane quarterback in quite some time.
Well, let me say this: I'm working all the time when Tulane's playing, so I really don't get to see him. But I was with an Oklahoma legend watching the Oklahoma Tulane game. And I swore to Spencer Tillman, I said, Tulane's covering in this game.
Yeah.
Not that I thought they'd have a chance to win, but that's the first time I watched Michael Pratt for extended amount of time. And I was just blown away by his poise. He goes into Norman, Oklahoma, after a hurricane, mind you, that they're supposed to play the game at home, and just acted like that was just another team. They were number two in the country.
He does. He is incredibly poised. Like, one moment, the moment I realized that he was the guy, it was one of his worst moments. Tulane's playing Tulsa his freshman year. It goes to double overtime.
Yeah.
Tulsa's conference defensive player of the year baits him, picks off a pass, runs it 100 yards for an interception. Everybody was acting like Michael Pratt was going to be destroyed. He got angry at people coming up to him saying, you're going to be okay. He's like, of course I'm going to be okay.
Yeah, dude,
I know what I'm doing. I'm a winner. I'm going to get over this. And that's his attitude. He's calm. He believes in himself, and he's getting better and better with each game he plays.
Well, he didn't get a touchdown in this season until the second half. The first half, though, Tajay Spears, the first game against UMass, got 3 rushing touchdowns. Mm-hmm. Tulane's got a history of running backs and some receivers, but the running back position, obviously, you got Dontrell Hilliard had 2 touchdowns for the Titans this past weekend. Matt Forte had a good career, but it seems like they churn him out. Mm-hmm. What makes him special, and how good can he be compared to these other guys?
I think Tajay Spears is going to be Tulane's best running back since Matt Forte. And like you just said, Dontrell Hilliard just scored 2 touchdowns in an NFL game.
That's
saying a lot. He had it. But Tajay Spears, he does it all. First time I saw him, they had a scrimmage a couple of years ago. He ran for an 80-yard touchdown. In the next scrimmage, he ran for an 80-yard touchdown. Nobody else is doing that, but he's the total package. He's elusive. He knows how to read defenses. He's tough. He's physical. And he's got breakaway speed on top of it. He's just got all the versatility and all the tools, and he's a good receiver too. He was ticketed to have a huge year 2 years ago. He had over 100 yards, I think, in the first quarter against Southern Miss. And then he tore his ACL on a touchdown run. It was a bad, ACL tear.
Yeah,
He lost. It took him a long time. He's talked about it. He had a hard time getting confidence. He's back and confident now. They didn't use him much the first few games because they want him to carry the load against Kansas State. Kansas State has the third leading running back in the country.
Deuce Vaughn's
awesome.
Phenomenal.
Tyjae Spears is going to take that as a challenge because he feels like he's as good as any running back in the country.
I'm going to tell you, I've done at least three Deuce Vaughn games over the last few years. He is special.
Yep.
And that brings me to my next question. The defense, obviously they've only given up 10 points. Big step up in competition. Deuce Vaughn's a real deal. He's going to be playing on Sundays without question. What makes this defense special so far, and how good can they be?
Right. Their linebackers are excellent. Nick Anderson and Dorian Williams. Now, Dorian Williams, another example. He was Pro Football Weekly picked him as the conference preseason player of the year last year.
Wow.
He, like the rest of the team, he didn't have a great year. The first two games this year, he's looking like that guy that they picked to be player of the year. This is his third year as a starter. He led the team in tackles in 2020. And Nick Anderson's the team leader on defense. He's the vocal leader. He's also a terrific player. He's in his third year as a starter. Those guys make plays all over the field. They're heady. They're smart. They do everything well. The key for Tulane, what we don't know is how the defensive line is going to hold up against Kansas State.
Right.
If the defensive line holds up, the back end is going to be able to make enough plays to give Tulane a chance to win, and we'll find out about the defense.
Remarkable stat you said before the show. Tulane, after six quarters, that's the halftime of the Alcorn State game, they've given up four completions only in six quarters, and they had four interceptions.
Correct.
Now, that's remarkable. I don't care who you're playing.
Right.
You could be playing the Carlton Boosters Little League. That's crazy.
Yeah.
What makes them good, and can they continue this the rest of the season defensively? We know the next two games they don't pass a whole lot.
Yeah, that's another question, because Tulane's weaknesses in recent years has been when they played the really good passing teams, they struggled in the secondary. But again, they have a ton of experience in the secondary. They've got Macon Clark in his third year as a starter. At nickelback this year. They've got Larry Brooks in his third year as a starter at safety. And Jaden Candy was their freshman, started against Oklahoma, picked off Spencer Rattler on the second play last year in his first ever college start, played all 11. He was one of the few Tulane players who really did have a great year last year. He's back for his second year. They're just loaded with experience in the secondary. Does that mean they're definitely going to play well against top-notch teams? We don't know that yet, but they certainly have a chance because these guys, the more you play, the better you get. And these guys, they have as much experience in the secondary as any team in the country.
Dude, I love talking to you because you don't you say it like it is, right? And you cover Tulane. Mm-hmm. And even when I would be optimistic sometimes and say 8-4 in years past, you're like, come on, bro, let's slow it down, maybe 6-6.
Yeah.
What realistically do you think this team can accomplish this season?
If you ask me next week, I'll know.
You'll know.
I do think this team has I picked them to go 7-5 before the year started, but I feel like their ceiling could be higher than that. I'll know a lot more after this Kansas State game because they haven't proven it. Willie Fritz, he's yet to beat a Power 5 conference school in his coaching career. He's come awfully close. The Oklahoma game is an example. When he was at Georgia Southern, they lost to Georgia in overtime. Let's see if they can go to Manhattan and beat Kansas State. That's a long shot, but it's not totally out of this realm possible.
I just looked at some of those upcoming games. Not easy. East Carolina almost beat North Carolina.
Yeah.
You have Houston, who I just saw. They're special. And obviously Kansas State and Southern Miss.
Yeah, and then after that, I don't think Tulane's going to lose to Southern Miss this year. But then they have their eight conference games. All of them, none of them are automatic because Tulane didn't catch a break. There's two really bad teams in the conference, Navy and Temple, and those are the two teams that Tulane is not playing.
Oh, that's not fair. Come on, get them back on the schedule. Give Willie a break.
I could see anything from, honestly, I could see anything from 4-8 to 8-4, 9-3, but I do like what I've seen in the first two games where I think the upper bar is more likely than I would have told you before the year.
Well, let's go for the 8-4. That's what we'll go for real quick. Hey, we give gifts. I know you have this TAS shirt. Yeah. Do you have the Tulane blue?
I do not.
This is not quite that. It used to be the old Tulane blue, but it's a beautiful shirt.
It is.
TAS Performance, and obviously Shays Ella Shays.
Yep.
You know where that is.
I certainly do.
Right by Tulane campus.
Yep.
So we appreciate you, Gary. Thank you. Hey, we're going to get a report from you on Sunday so I can say on the show next Tuesday about what you think going forward, okay?
Looking forward to it.
That's Gary Smith. Thank you so much. Like I said, next week we're going to have Glenn Gilbo talk about LSU, and they play Mississippi State coming up, so that'll be interesting. Got a lot of people to thank. Will Hill, our producer, cannot get this done without him. So thankful he's there. And my man, Logan Graffia, and Alex Chacon. And don't forget my man, Jim Dotson, and of course, Ron Yeager. Hey, we're coming back next week right here on Primetime Sports. We'll see you then.
positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative, but don't
Gold
mess
mine.
With Mr.
701 Dauphine Street in New Orleans.
Got to spread joy up to the maximum and bring gloom.